أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم لا سيما بقية الله روحي وأرواح العالمين لمقدمه الفداء. My respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. The first Tuesday of the month of Sha'ban in this year, Christian calendar, the year 2020, that you would remember it better. We are observing the month of Sha'ban as preparation for the holy month of Ramadan in a very unique situation, a situation that the whole world, not only one particular nation, a particular country or individual, collectively humanity is facing a great challenge. I call it a challenge, and inshallah I want to mention tonight that this challenge is an opportunity, and you can enjoy this opportunity as a platform for your perfection or a platform to jump down. I remember many years ago, one of my colleagues, classmates back then, He informed the late Ayatollah Bahjat that a student of the Hawza, due to severe poverty, he committed a suicide. And the late Ayatollah Bahjat, Rahmatullah Alayhi, he said that was a platform for his perfection. So two people stay at the platform. One jumps down and kills himself before the train. Another one is using that opportunity to embark on the train, plane or anything, and ascend or get a destination. By the way, what I'm trying to say, inshallah, tonight is that situations as such are definitely opportunities. But it depends on our ideology, how we perceive it and how we deal with it. And this is definitely, again, one of the situations that you can see the distinct differences between believers and disbelievers. For the believers, no matter what, absolutely not, there's nothing more challenging than losing the life. Even as I will give you examples of our noble role models, even the loss of life, so far as they are, you are on the right track, means nothing other than good and beauty. So when the Quran says Allah bidhikrillah tatma'innul qulub, lo and behold, that with remembrance of God you are confidently in peace of mind and confidently you enjoy your life and you're comfortable, that is not only when everything is going smoothly in life, whether it's going smoothly or supposedly not, whether you're facing a challenge or supposedly not, a believer who is always God conscious enjoys their life and they're very positive and very optimistic about life. In contrast to that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us the very first characteristics of disbelievers, those who don't believe in life beyond this material life, or answers wal mushrikeena wal mushrikat. Disbelievers, whether males or females. The first character is this. Abbanina billahi dhanna saw. They are the ones who are very negative in their approach, in their ideology. Oh, this is the time of madness. God is cruel. Why all of this is happening? I lost my job. I lost my dear. I lost my mother. Why God is doing this to me? Where is God when it hurts? Complaint after complaint. Quran says, عَلَيْهِمْ دَائِرَةُ سَوْءٍ. They are encompassed and engulfed in all this pessimism. In their own thoughts, in fact. In their own thoughts, and they suffer. And naturally, this kind of lifestyle is very depressive. Whereas the other side of it, a believer, no matter what, no matter how harsh the situation may sound in the eyes of others, I give you some example and you please compare it with your situation and you see that how comfortably you and I are enjoying our life. The role models, the noble, infallible role models that the Almighty God in the Quran or in the lifestyle of our Ma'sumin we read are for a reason. For you and I to apply them to our day-to-day life. Imagine this situation. Now, there is a recommendation, global recommendation these days, that the best, safest place for you is to stay at home with your family. Enjoy the company of your family, your children, that unfortunately usually were so much caught in the rat race of dunya, hardly had time to see your children. Now the Almighty God has forced you, provided that opportunity, to spend more time with your family. Comfort zone of your home, alhamdulillah, inshallah, things are provided. You have a shelter about you, the company of your family, your dear, you enjoy them. And yet people complain. Now imagine this, that if you were imprisoned for a sin that you had never committed, and not that you are house arrested, you would be in a dungeon that you have no idea about the sunlight, nor about the moon and the stars of the night. In other words, you don't see the day, you don't see the night. Deep under the ground. All right? For how long? Indefinite. And who are you? The most innocent, infallible person existing at your lifetime. I'm talking about Imam Musa al-Kadhim alayhi salam. Salamullah alayhi. Now, anyone in less than that situation would be depressed. People in much less than that with no faith commit suicide. Okay? Or at least they become suicidal. Imam Musa al-Kadhim alayhi salam, on the contrary, in his supplication, in the dungeon, in that situation, the Imam says, Allahumma, innaka ta'lam annani kuntu as'aluka an tufarrighani li'ibadatik. Allahumma, waqad fa'alta, falaka alhamd. Oh Allah, I can never thank you good enough. You know that for long I've been begging you, I've been asking you to provide an opportunity for me to be isolated. For what? To be me and you alone, so that I have no distraction, no worldly distraction at all, so that I can spend more intimate time with you in worshiping you. God, now you have provided that. In the dungeon, deep under the ground, no disturbance, no one is disturbing me. فَلَكَ الْحَمْدُ. I'm so grateful to you. Can you see that? Do you see this positive thinking? Do you see how a believer enjoys their life even deep under the ground, the most innocent person? When we read the story of Prophet Yusuf again, imagine the most innocent person of his time. And he's given the option of either living a royal luxury life in the palace of the king, but sinful, filthy and sinful life, or being imprisoned for a sin that you even avoided it. Prophet Yusuf, this is the difference. This is the lifestyle of a believer. Rabbi, Rabbi Sejno Ahabu Ilay Memma Yad'unani Ilay. Rabbi Sejno Ahabu Ilay Memma Yad'unani Ilay. Oh my Lord, I'd rather be imprisoned. I'd rather be imprisoned but not having a filthy, dirty lifestyle, sinful lifestyle. This is the power of positive thinking that a believer, by connecting themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, enjoys. There is a part in dua, in Ziyarat Ashura, at the end of Ziyarat Ashura, this heavenly Ziyarat that I refer to it as the article of the Shia faith. Ziyarat Ashura ends with Sejdeh, as you know. This Sejdeh, brothers and sisters, is Sejdeh to Shukr. It's a Sejdeh of gratitude and being grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know that the first person that we know of that has uttered Ziyarat Ashura, that recorded for us, is Imam Baqir alayhi salam. Imam Baqir, in the tragedy of Karbala, was 4 years old. He had lost his grandfather, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, his uncles, his nephews, all right? Allahu Akbar. Imagine again this situation. Let us for a second, even hypothetically speaking, putting ourselves in the shoes, as we say, of Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam, a four-year-old boy that had witnessed, eyewitnessed that tragic event of Karbala on the day of Ashura. Having lost the most noble people of the family of the Prophet, that they were slaughtered brutally. Yet for the rest of his life, because when the Imam says that if you can read this ziyarah every day, that means the Imam has been practicing it himself every day. At the end of this Ziyarat Ashura, Imam prostrates, the prostration of gratitude, thanksgiving prostration, and the Imam says, Allahumma, lakal hamd, hamda shakirin alak. To be honest with you, Anytime I get an opportunity to read Ziyarat Ashura, when I come to this part of the Sijda of Ziyarat Ashura, I'll be extra, inshallah, honest with you, I'm contemplating, am I really saying this for myself? Often I make intention that I just repeat the word of a Mansour, because that's the word of Mansour. I think this is way beyond my intellect to comprehend it. How can I really, putting yourself in that situation, it's very difficult for my intellect to perceive it, that you have lost all your dears and yet you prostrate to God as a means of thanksgiving. Say, Ya Allah, Allahumma lakal hamd ash-shakirin. Imagine all brown people around the world, past, present and the future, how they want to be grateful to God. I want all that for me. For what? Ala musabihim. For the calamity that befell on them. Allahumma lakal hamd, hamd ash-shakirin, ala musabihim. Alhamdulillah ala azim raziyati. Allahu Akbar. That's what I told you, that the wording are so profound beyond our intellect. Oh Allah, alhamdulillah ala azim raziyati. The greater the calamity, the more grateful I am. Allahu Akbar. Now you know that why Sayyidah Zainab, after the tragedy of Karbala, she eyewitnessed the tragedy of Karbala on the day of Ashura, post Ashura, the evening, the hard deep evening of Ashura, then being taken as captives of war all the way through, and when in Sham or in Kufa, according to different narrations, she was asked, how did you perceive the scene? Imagine the hardship you are going sometimes in your life, and then they tell you, how would you perceive it? Oh, why God is cruel? Why God did this to me? Why coming with all the complaints out of our ignorance? But a true believer, like Sayyidah Zainab, she turned and answers, Ma ra'aytu illa jameela. Unfortunately, usually there's a common mistake here. Translators, they did not get to the word of Sayyidah Zainab. It is usually this phrase translated that I saw but a beauty. She didn't say Ma ra'aytu illa jamalan, I saw only a beauty. No, she says I saw only God. But she wants to tell us she saw only benevolent God. She only saw the beautiful God. She says, because Jamil means beautiful. Jamal means beauty. She didn't say, Ma ra'aytu illa jamalan, I saw only beauty. No, she says, she's a muwahhida. She's a monotheist. She says only God. And because God is good and the source of all goodness, God is beautiful and the source of all beauty, instead of saying Ma ra'aytu illa Allah alladhi huwa jameel, she's eloquent. She says Ma ra'aytu illa jameela. I only saw the beautiful with capital B. And I only saw God with, yes, in His divine attribute of beauty, within all the hardship. Brothers and sisters, in Surah Al-Kahf, chapter 18 of the Quran, there's a story that I always tell my clients, those have some family issues, financial issues, or hardship in their life, I always remind them that as a believer, remember that you are also the Moses of your story, and your intellect, your knowledge of religion, supposed to be your mentor. As Moses had a mentor named as Khidr, your Khidr is your knowledge. Your Khidr is your faith, true faith in God, that comes to your aid and to your rescue at this difficult time. All right, what does it mean? It means when you don't know, when you cannot uncover the secrets of things that are happening to you, rest assured, sit back comfortably and say that I know that the steering is in the hand of the most benevolent, omnipotent, omniscient, omnibenevolent God, all wise God. I cannot comprehend it, but I know that things are happening for a good reason. You think positive things will happen to you. It's not Sheikh Mansour's word. I'm quoting from the Almighty, All-Knowing God. أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْقِتَالُ وَهُوَ كُرُّهٌ لَكُمْ. The Almighty God says that combat, fighting, one meaning of it is fighting in the battlefield, that you understand. But yes, another meaning of it is that fighting an invisible virus, for example. كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْقِتَالُ وَهُوَ كُرْهٌ لَكُمْ. You don't like it. Why this is happening? وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمْ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. The Almighty God says, is this the first time that you didn't like things, you disliked things, but they were good in it? Time with time you discover some of the goodness in it. And is this the first time that you liked something and time proved you wrong? Things that you prayed for it and time proved you wrong. Why? The wisdom, the reason for that is the following. Because وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمْ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Because God knows, you and I don't know. You and I don't know. Let's admit it that we don't know. Leave it to the hand of, as it is in the hand of the Almighty and all-knowing God. So, the question is that, so why this is all happening? Why all of a sudden we have a global, and some people they try to say, is it the sign of the coming of Imam Zaman? Is it the sign of the end of the world? Is it because of our sins? All of the above. But again, I want to bring it back to you, as Quran says, when they ask the Almighty God why this is happening, instead of the Almighty God telling them why this is happening, God tells us what you and I are supposed to do. What you need to ask is not why this is happening. What you and I we need to ask God is that, God, what is my duty? What are you expecting from me? One of the Arafa is saying that when you see hurdles in your life, hardship in your life, imagine like someone metaphorically is tapping on your shoulder. You turn and say that, yes, God, what do you want from me? What is expected from me? What is my duty here? أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وبلوناهم بالحسنات والسيئات لعلهم يرجعون. The Almighty God says that I test you. I kept testing you with all the ease in your life, all the comfort in your life. Unfortunately, that made you more into a sleep. That's why I have to wake you up sometimes through hardship, بالسيئات, things that you dislike, so that لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ, that they may understand that it's about the time to make a U-turn. Alhamdulillah, some people are taking advantage of it. In the last few days, few weeks, especially as things get more severe, by the grace of God, more God consciousness comes to the surface. Brothers, sisters are asking me about their duty. I have that many years of salat, lapsed fasting. How can I make them up? Very good, very positive. That's what is expected to do. That's what we are expected to do, to better our relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Use this issue of global fighting coronavirus as a platform for your nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is an assignment I usually give to my students. The students are familiar with this. With this assignment, I'll tell them, go and ask five random people, Muslim, non-Muslims, males, females, you choose, doesn't matter who, and tell them, put this question to them and tell them, please think about it. The question is the following. You can also seriously think about it. The question is the following. Imagine that your GP tells you that, look, you are diagnosed with a fatal disease that there's no cure for it, and you've got 1 month to live. How are you going to spend the last months of your life? The assignment is to ask them, believers or disbelievers, because this is for everybody. Even if you deny the existence of God, you cannot deny the existence of death. Yeah, also it's for all of us, young, old, male, females, believers, disbelievers. So the question is that, imagine that this is 1 month I have, how am I going to spend the last months of my life? Your honest answer to that question determines whether you are heedless or heedful, whether you are on the right track or not. If truly, and I tell you that, normally the answer comes to me are of these two kinds. Religious people, God-conscious people, they usually their answer contains examples that makes them, they want to do things that makes them more religious, more practicing Muslims, by going to Hajj, Ziyarat, making up for my lapsed Salat, fasting and the like. Things that the religious conscience is telling them, you have to do it. That they've been slacking about it. Non-religious people, usually they say that, I would spend more time with my family. SubhanAllah, God has provided that opportunity to you. In that exercise, in that assignment, we assume that you've got 1 month. Hey, the reality is that when the angel of death comes, usually doesn't give you notice of vacancy. Nobody knows when, where, and how. So always take it like this. So this coronavirus is to wake up the world. If the world doesn't wake up, you and I individually, we are expected to be among the first to wake up to ourselves. Am I truly on the right track? Am I doing what I'm supposed to do? If it was really the last months of my life, if we live this type of lifestyle, inshallah, we would be having taken advantage of the opportunity. Being the Tuesday evening, the night of connection with Imam Zaman. You know that we don't differentiate between the Masumeen. As we don't differentiate, as Quran says, between the Prophets, we don't differentiate between the Masumeen. However, we are instructed by the Masumeen, alayhi wasalam, themselves, that at the moment, our present time, at our present time, our present Imam is our direct means between us and the Almighty God. You want the relief of this current situation, we have no choice but pleading to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala using the means that He has provided to us and He has authenticated for us, and at our present time, that is Sahib al-Asr wa al-Zaman. There is one dua known as dua al-Faraj. You know, we have two dua faraj. One, Allahumma kun li waliyik. Another one, when you're more desperate, in a situation of desperation, and perhaps like now, and God knows how more severe it's going to be. There are different, a slight difference of the versions for it. I'm taking it from the original source for you, from the book of Misbah al-Kaf'ami. Kaf'ami, one of our very eminent scholars and the mystics and the Urafa of Ahl-Suluk of the 9th century, from Jabal Amil, rahmatullah alayhi, in his book Al-Misbah, he says that this is the supplication that Sahib al-Asr wa al-Zaman told someone who was imprisoned innocently. One of the followers of Ahlul Bayt al-Musallam innocently was imprisoned, and Imam Zaman goes to him and is teaching him this dua and tells him that you read this dua with the presence of heart, understanding the meaning, of course, the Almighty God, inshallah, will give you the relief. With that, inshallah, I want to conclude. Inshallah, I provided a translation. They can put the translation, inshallah, on the screen for you so that you can follow the meaning. اللهم عظم البلاء وبرح الخفاء وانكشف الغطاء وانقطع الرجاء وضاقت الأرض ومنعت السماء وأنت المستعان وإليك المشتكى وعليك المعول في الشدة والرخاء اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد أولي الأمر الذين فرضت علينا طاعتهم وعرفتنا بذلك منزلتهم ففرج عنا بحقهم فرجا عاجلا قريبا كلمح البصر أو هو أغرام. Everybody, يا محمد يا علي يا علي يا محمد اكفياني فإنكما كافياي وانصراني فإنكما ناصراي يا مولانا يا صاحب الزمان الأمان 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 الغوث 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 أدركني 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 الساعة 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 العجلة 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 يا أرحم الراحمين بمحمد وآله الطاهرين صلوات اللهم صل على محمد وآله